innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
This is the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Good morning, I'm Christian Esguera, and this is Matters of Fact. Here are today's headlines. The World Health Organization cautions the Philippines against easing COVID-19 restrictions after Metro Manila mayors voted to shift to modified general community quarantine next month. The Philippines detects two new coronavirus mutations in Region 7. Some Philippine senators say there's no need for the proposed 500 million peso indemnification fund for recipients of COVID-19 vaccines. And Aureen seen to intensify into a severe tropical storm over the next 48 hours. A razor-thin majority of Metro Manila mayors are in favor of placing the capital region under the most relaxed quarantine status next month. But health experts caution against such a move, saying the government should roll out vaccines first. Zen Hernandez reports.
Economic managers are urgently calling for an easing of restrictions by placing the entire country under modified general community quarantine. This after statistics showed that hunger and unemployment remained high in areas like Metro Manila, which remain under the more restrictive status. Metro Manila mayors had various opinions, but to settle things once and for all, they put it to a vote. The result, 9 voted in favor of easing restrictions against 8 who voted against it. The 8 oppositionists respect the results, but they assert the need to enforce a more strict and enhance health and safety protocols.
Since yan na yung decision ng mayorya, we will follow and siguro iisip na kami ng mas magandang mga health protocols para naman hindi ma-overwhelm yung healthcare system.
The National Economic and Development Authority has recommended localized lockdowns to avoid the surge of COVID cases while increasing the capacity of public transportation to 75% and gradually allowing a wider range of age groups out of their homes, particularly those aged 5 to 70 years old. There is also a plan to resume limited face-to-face classes. But this early, at least one city mayor is against it.
They will be saying that a limited face-to-face classes will be held here in Marikina. We will not hold classes until such time that we could fully reconfigure and determine the capacity of our school system to hold such activity.
Others appealed for a gradual easing of restrictions.
Tandaan niyo ang pressure po na sa amin, ang responsibilidad na sa amin.
Valenzuela Mayor Rex Gatchalian, meanwhile, is studying imposing stiffer penalties for violations against health and safety protocols once the MGCQ is enforced.
Kasi nitong nakalipas na mga araw, nakakita tayo ng increase sa aming mga kaso. And bagamat pababa na siya ulit, ang pakiramdam namin ng mga doktor sa City Hall, hindi pa stable yung ground. Parang gumagalaw pa siya. So gusto muna namin na makita na may pattern talaga na bumaba na ng puspusan at flat na siya bago sana kami magre-recommend na luwagan yung quarantine status sa Venezuela.
The World Health Organization representative to the Philippines cautioned against a large-scale relaxation of anti-COVID measures.
If we relax measures too early, we see that the rebound happens very fast. So we need to keep this in mind and be very careful in relaxing those restriction measures as we see transmission rates dropping.
The OCTA Research Group says easing restrictions would put Metro Manila under a constant threat of surge in cases due to increased mobility. The group calls on government to wait for the vaccine rollout before easing quarantine measures. Malacañang thanked the Metro Manila mayors for their readiness to address problems on unemployment and hunger. The recommendations will still have to be discussed by President Duterte and his cabinet on Monday for a final approval. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
The number of COVID-19 cases in the country has breached the 555,000 mark after over 1,000 new infections were reported on Thursday. As Rafael Bosano tells us, health experts are calling for vigilance while the country waits for the arrival of the vaccines.
Dr. Benilda Galvez of the Lung Center of the Philippines will be the first to receive the COVID-19 vaccine allotted for the hospital. She has been at the forefront of the battle not only against COVID-19, but other infectious diseases in recent years.
Nagdadarasal ako na talagang dumating na kasi ang tagal ng paghihintay. So alam naman natin, bakuna talaga ang makakatulong, malaking tulong upang sana'y mawakasan na itong pandemyang ito. More of anticipating and full of gratitude na meron na tayong available vaccine.
Hospital staff know all too well the importance of getting vaccinated. The hospital's emergency room head nurse admits he was among those who initially had reservations in getting a shot.
More on excited na makareceive na, para at least kasi ang pinaka-aim mo bakit kailangan ma-vaccine ka is para unang-una added protection, hindi lang para sa sarili mo. Kapag vaccinated ka o bakunado ka na, syempre pag uwi mo ng bahay, is protected din yung iyong mga pamilya. Paano mo may encourage yung iba, mga pangkaraniwang tao, kung ikaw mismo na healthcare worker is ayaw magpabakuna?
Dr. Lulu Bravo, the Philippine Foundation for Vaccination, says vaccine hesitancy remains a major hurdle in getting the public on board and excited for the arrival of vaccines.
Marami ang gustong magpabakuna, kaya lang marami silang tanong. At ang gusto nila, masagot yung tanong nila. Sa palagay ko naman, pag nasagot natin ng maayos ang kanilang mga katanungan tungkol sa kaligtasan, sa vaccine safety, sino pwedeng bakunahan, pag na-explain natin ng malinaw yan, palagay ko talaga, manhat ng mga pwedeng mapabakunahan, eh mabibigyan natin ng karampatang idea at paliwanag. Dadami ng dadami ang magpapabakuna. Ang problema, kulang ang bakuna.
Bravo also stressed, the public should also understand that receiving the vaccine doesn't mean people can be complacent, noting that the vaccine only reduces the chances of a severe or critical infection. This is why even after vaccination, it is important to adhere to minimum public health standards, especially now that experts are seeing that the overall COVID-19 situation in the country is improving. According to the latest report of the OCTA Research, in the last 4 months, the number of cases has remained pretty much the same. While several local governments in the National Capital Region are seeing a slight increase in cases, the reproduction number and positivity rate remain to be on the good side. Should restrictions be eased and the reproduction number increase to 1.6, the OCTA Group projects COVID-19 cases to rise to 2,400 daily by March 26. This was the same scenario in August last year that prompted health workers to call for a timeout and revert the region to a modified enhanced community quarantine status. As the Philippines continue to wait for vaccines to arrive, hospitals continue to improve processes in their vaccine rollout. The spokesperson of the Lung Center of the Philippines says the public should stay vigilant and patient, even as the country's neighbors have kicked off their vaccination.
It's probably a lesson on patience more than anything else. But while waiting, we just have to keep ourselves safe and continue the standard health protocols we have been advising time and again since last year.
The Philippines' pandemic task force is expected to come out with a new resolution this morning. Let's listen in.
Ito po, no? The following shall be included, added to the list of foreign nationals allowed to the Philippines: those with valid and existing visas at the time of entry and who were not permitted to enter the country under previous IATF resolutions, and holders of valid and existing special resident and retirees visas and Section 9A visas, provided they present an entry exemption document to the Bureau of Immigration upon arrival. Okay, so March 16, 2020, wala na po yung reckoning period na yan. No? So, yan po ang ating balitang IATF. Aljo, meron ba ho tayong mga tanong galing sa ating mga kasama sa Malacañang Press Corps?
Opo, Attorney Roque, may recommendation ang Metro Manila Mayors na posibleng bang ma-shift na natin sa MGCQ, lalo na dito sa Metro Manila sa buwan ng Marso? Ano po ang
well, sabihin na lang po natin na nagkasundo na, no, yung IATF na nagrekomenda sa ating presidente na magkaroon na ng MGCQ sa buong Pilipinas at ang mga alkalde sa Metro Manila. So inaasahan naman natin, dahil meron ng ganitong kasunduan, no, sa panig ng IATF at ng mga Metro Manila mayors, eh baka naman po sumang-ayon ng ating presidente. Magkakaroon po ang desisyon ng ating presidente itong Lunes 22, bagamat baka ito po i-anunsyo ko bago po matapos ang buwan ng Pebrero.
Marami pa rin po nagtatanong, Attorney Roque, kung kailan ba talaga darating ang mga bakuna. At ang ating pong narinig sa panig po ng pamahalaan ay maingat ang ating gobyerno sa pagpasok ng mga kontratang ito. Tiniwasan natin yung tinatag na onerous contract. Update po tayo, Attorney Roque.
Well, alam niyo po talagang ang sinabi sa atin ng COVAX facility, darating yung kanilang Pfizer, dapat sa gitna ng Pebrero.
Opo.
Pero naantala nga po ito, no, bakit tapatan na po, no, ang Pfizer, ang siya rin gumawa nung Dengvaxia na bakuna, no, na naging dahilan kung bakit nakasuhan ng hindi lang mga opisyalis ng gobyerno, kundi pati opisyalis ng Pfizer. Sa kaya humihingi po sila nung tinatawag na indemnity agreement, dahil lang kanilang bakuna naman ay covered ng EUA lang, no, emergency use authorization, at hindi pa ng general use authorization, no. At gumalaw naman po ang ating pamahalaan, ang Kongreso ay bumubuo ng isang batas ngayon na nagsasabi na gobyerno na magbabayad ng danyos para sa lahat ng magkakaroon ng side effects dahil dito sa mga bakunang paparating, no. At na-certified naman po ito kahapon as urgent ng ating presidente, kaya inaasahan nating magiging batas ito. Pero ang katotohanan din ay, dahil nga po limitadong supply, pati po yung AstraZeneca na i-deliver dapat ng COVAX facility, ngayon po, bago matapos ang buwan ng Pebrero, darating, no? At ito rin po ay subject to logistical challenges dahil napakadami nga pong kumukuha ng AstraZeneca. Ganun pa man, ay yung dinodonate sa atin ng bansang China na Sinovac, inaasahan pa rin nating darating ng 23 ng buwan ito, kaya nga lang, nakasaad dun sa kanilang deed of donation, kumbaga, na kinakailangan, meron na tayong EUA para sa AstraZeneca bago pa man siya dumating ng 23. So kung maantala yung pag-i-issue ng EUA ng FDA para sa Sinovac, baka hindi rin makarating po yung Sinovac sa 23, pero tatapating ko na po kayo. Si Presidente ang nagsalita na, siya mismo na iinip na, kinakailangan dumating na ang mga bakuna. Kaya naman siguro, dahil nagsalita na ng ganyan ng presidente, gagalaw na ng mas mabilis ang lahat.
Opo. Kahapon po, nakausap ko si Justice Velasco, Attorney Roque. At may mga mungkain silang kung papayagan sana mga LGUs na direktang bumili o mag-procure ng mga bakuna. Update po tayo sa usaping yan, na spokesman.
Ang problema po kasi, kaya hindi sila makabili na diretso eh dahil wala pa nga pong general use authorization ng mga gamot nito. Ibig sabihin, limitado lang po ang pagbebenta at ang pagbebenta nila ay under emergency use lamang. Kaya hindi po ito nabibili sa pribadong merkado, no? Ito po ay kumbaga special arrangement between sa mga vaccine developers at mga gobyerno. Ang intindihan nila, marami pa tayo hindi nalalaman sa mga bakunang ito, huwag mo kaming panagutin, pero sa ngayon kasi kinakailangan gamitin na yung bakuna at sinasabi naman ng mga dalubhasa na ligtas at epektibo itong mga bakunang ito, no? So yan po ang dahilan. Pero ngayon po, nag-issue na ng memorandum order ang presidente kahapon lamang na nagbibigay ng kapangyarihan sa mga lokal na pamalahan na magbayad ng hanggang 15% advance payment doon sa mga bakunang binili nila sa pamamagitan ng tripartite agreement kung saan bahagi sa kontrata yung manufacturer, yung local government at siyempre po ang national government pa rin.
Secretary Roque, magandang umaga po sa inyo. Si Diane Kerr po ito. Mayroon pong katanungan mula po sa aming pumalakanyang reporter na si Mel Alasmoras. Kasama rin daw po sa inaprubahan kahapon ng inyong IATF ang amendment on mass gatherings sa ilalim ng GCQ na makikita sa Omnibus Guidelines on the Implementation of Community Quarantine in the Philippines. Ito ay para tumugma sa mga negosyo, mga industriya at mga aktibidad na pinayagan na sa mga naunang IATF resolution. Maari daw po bang paki-specify kung ano-ano ang naging amendment sa mass gatherings? Yun daw po bang mga bata or 5 to 70 years old, papayagan na po bang lumabas sa mga ito? Secretary Roque.
Hindi pa po covered yung mga 5 to 75. In fact, ang sumang-ayo ng mga alkalde ay sa edad na 17 hanggang 65, no? Pero yung resolution na yon ay para maging uniform lang kung ano yung mga industriya yung bukas dahil alam natin at inaasahan natin na maging MGCQ na ang Metro Manila at ang buong Pilipinas. So ibig sabihin, aalisin na natin yung mga special na mga rules para sa Metro Manila at mga ibang lugar na GCQ. Isahang rules na lang ngayon, no? Kung ano yung pinapayagang magbukas sa MGCQ, eh syempre, yan na po yung mapapwedeng magbukas. At ang kasama po dyan, yung mga religious gatherings at 50%. Yung mga sinihan at subject dun sa capacity na sasabihin ng ating mga lokal na pamahalaan, yung mga parks, yung mga amusement parks, no? So ibig sabihin po, pwede na rin po magkaroon ng mass gatherings na up to subject to 50% capacity, no? Dahil yan naman po ay allowed sa MGCQ. So lilinawin ko po, ang ginawa lang po ng IATF resolution sa paghahanda ng pagkakaroon ng MGCQ sa buong Pilipinas, reiterate na po natin na wala na yung mga special rules sa GCQ dahil lahat po tayo ngayon covered ng mga rules under MGCQ, no? At least pagsimula ng auuno ng Marso at kung papayagan po ng ating presidente.
Opo. Ano pong update natin sa pagpasok po ng mga turista sa bansa, Attorney Roque?
Sa aking pagkakaalam, hindi pa rin po pinapayagan ang mga turista. Bagat case-to-case basis, pwede po silang kumuha ng exemption, no? Pero sa ngayon po, ang pinapayagan lang, eh, lahat ng mga visas ng mga namumuhunan, mga nagtatrabaho, mga kamag-anak ng mga Pilipino, no? Yung mga may asawa ng mga Pilipino at mga may anak. Halos lahat ng dayuhan except ang mga turista.
Opo. May tanong dito si Joseph Morong. Tama ba ito? Update sa turista. Kasama na ba dyan yung love is not tourism? Ito yung love.
Ang love is not tourism po kasi is tourist visa pa rin, no?
Opo, opo.
So, antay-antay lang po tayo. Mukhang malapit na yan pero hindi pa po, no? Lahat po ng mga long-term visas na na-issue natin, eh po pwede na pong pumasok. So, antayin na lang po natin kung kailan papayagan ng mga turista.
Yung face-to-face classes po para sa mga estudyante, yun ba ay posible, Attorney Roque?
Yan po ay pag-uusapan sa Lunes muli, no? At kahapon nga sa ating press briefing, in-explain ni Secretary Lenore Briones na ito naman ay naunahang naaprubahan ng IATF bagamat panandali ang tinigil natin dahil nga pumasok yung new variant. Pero ngayong naintindihan na natin itong new variant nito at mukha namang wala pa tayong community transmission sa new variant, bubuhayin muli yung pag-uusap tungkol sa face-to-face dahil gaya ng sinabi ni Secretary Briones, parang tayo na lang pong bansa na wala pang face-to-face no, sa buong mundo. No? At hindi naman sinabi na baliba sa face-to-face, yan po 8 hours, 5 days a week. No? Pwede namang 1 hour per week or 3 hours per week. Basta meron lang pong kombinasyon ng module, ng computer-aided, at saka face-to-face kung kinakailangan makipag-ugnayan sa mga guro.
Opo. Mensahe na lang, Spokesman Roque, sa ating mga kababayan, ngayon marami pa rin po ang nangangamba, ayaw po magpabakuna dahil po sa takot nila, dulot pa rin nung nangyari po sa issue ng Dengvaxia.
Well, una, lilinawin ko, no? Mukhang mali ang nasabi ko kanina. Okay. Ang manufacturer po ng Dengvaxia ay Sanofi, not Pfizer. Okay. Pero alam nyo po, puro Europeans yan. Nag-uusap-usap po yan. Kaya nga po, parang naging mas maingat ang Pfizer bilang isang kapwa European manufacturer ng Sanofi pagdating sa pagsusupply ng emergency use authorization. Ang akin lang naman po, uulitin ko ang sinabi po ng mga dalubhasa dahil ako naman po hindi doktor, hindi dalubhasa, pero sinabi po ni dating Secretary Cabral, na unang-una, ang Dengvaxia po, dumaan po sa proseso. Hindi lang sa Pilipinas, kung hindi sa buong mundo at sa WHO. Ito po'y binigyan ng general use certification, hindi lang po emergency use authorization. At ito po ay desisyon ng WHO at ng lahat ng mga dalubhasa daigdig na ligtas talaga yung Dengvaxia para gamitin nga sa dengue. No? Pero, ang nangyari po dito sa Pilipinas, nagkaroon po ng kontrobersiya, hindi pa naman po napapatunayan ang mga namatay ay dahil sa Dengvaxia, nagkaroon lang nga po ng pagkatakot. Kaya nga po, ngayon, umaapila kami. Unang-una, Pilipinas, pakinggan po natin ang mga dalubhasa. Hindi po ibig sabihin na doktor ay lahat ng doktor po pwede na magkomento pagdating sa mga bakuna. Kinakailangan po pakinggan natin ang mga epidemiologists, pakinggan natin yung mga specialista, mga vaccinologists. No? At lahat naman po sila yung nagsasabi na bagamat emergency use authorization, mas marami yung benepisyong makukuha natin sa mga bakuna ng COVID-19, laban sa COVID-19, kesa dun sa kanilang posibleng mga side effects. So magtiwala naman po tayo sa eksperto dahil sa panahon ng pandemya, sa panahon ng health emergency, sino papaniniwalaan natin kung hindi ang mga dalubhasa?
Maraming salamat po, Spokesman Attorney Harry Roque.
So that was Presidential Spokesman Harry Roque appealing to the public to listen to the real health experts to address this growing concern regarding a vaccine hesitancy, especially with the planned rollout of COVID-19 vaccines by the Philippine government. But of course, according to Secretary Roque, he was quite candid in saying that there's a delay, of course, in the arrival of the Pfizer vaccines because Pfizer, the pharmaceutical company, was concerned with what happened with the Dengvaxia vaccine produced by Sanofi Pasteur a few years ago, which created this big controversy, which also affected the vaccine hesitancy or acceptance here in the Philippines. Pfizer wanted an assurance, an indemnification agreement with the Philippine government to be able to avoid encountering the same problem that was encountered by Sanofi Pasteur before. And also he said that the AstraZeneca COVID-19 vaccines are expected to arrive by the end of February, but subject to logistical challenges. Also, according to Secretary Roque, Sinovac vaccine from China, those vaccines are expected to arrive on February 23rd, but the Chinese manufacturer of Sinovac wanted the FDA to also issue emergency use authorization for AstraZeneca, which if this wouldn't happen, the Sinovac vaccine arrival might also be affected, according to Secretary Roque. And also, he said that the president is expected to decide on whether to place Metro Manila, including the rest of the Philippines, under the more relaxed quarantine arrangement, which is the modified general community quarantine, since this was already agreed upon by the mayors in Metro Manila and the IATF. Now, in other news, President Duterte has granted amnesty to members of several rebel groups, including the Moro National Liberation Front and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, who have committed crimes for their political beliefs in the past. The proclamations, however, state amnesty cannot be granted to persons who have been proscribed as terrorists or charged under the Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020. Joining us now is Attorney Nagiba Sinarimbo. He's the Interior Minister of the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARM. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us again on the program.
Good morning, Christian. Magandang umaga sa mga kababayan natin.
Okay, let's start with the basics. Why President Duterte in the first place had to issue an amnesty proclamation for rebels belonging to the MILF as part of the normalization process, as part of the peace agreement?
Yes, Christian. It's part of the comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro, specifically in the annex on normalization. There's a provision for confidence-building measures. One of the confidence-building measures enumerated there is the grant of amnesty to members of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front.
Okay, and how many MILF combatants are expected to benefit from this proclamation?
We don't have the exact numbers as yet, but from the initial meetings that we have conducted in the Joint Normalization Committee, there will be roughly around 1,000 members of the MILF. The numbers are still being determined because some of the cases filed do not have specific names from the members of the MILF. So there are jandos and jendes in some of the information filed against their members.
Okay, isn't that a bit small compared to the 40,000 combatants that are expected to decommission?
We will have to get the numbers from different offices of government, from the Office of the Prosecution Services, from different areas, those that have been filed in courts, as well as those still being processed in the law enforcement agencies of government. So we don't have the exact numbers yet.
Now, just for clarification, what exactly does an amnesty proclamation do? Does it extinguish the crime or just the punishment?
In legal parlance, amnesty erases the criminal liability and restores political rights to the individual. So you enjoy all the rights that every citizen normally enjoys.
And why is this important in the first place in the context of the peace agreement that was signed by the Philippine government with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front in 2014?
Two very important things for that. One is that there is a provision that allows MILF, in fact, encourages MILF to transition into civilian life. So this one would at least allow them to be reintegrated into society again. The other one is that if they are to participate in political exercises, such as the right to vote, or be voted for in the event they want to participate in the political process, cases would affect their chances of running for public office. So okay. It's important that we have the amnesty.
Now, does the amnesty proclamation, of course, that was issued by the president, which would also require congressional concurrence. But in this case, how high up in the hierarchy are we talking about here in terms of those who are expected to benefit from the proclamation?
There are members of the Central Committee, the highest organ of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. There are also very senior commanders on the field, such as front commanders, base commanders, and senior commanders of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front.
Is there any among those who are serving now in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, in the BTA, the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, that are expected to be included in the list that would benefit from the proclamation?
Yes, definitely, Christian.
Okay. Now, ito, I'm asking the basic questions because people might be asking this. For instance, how come they were allowed to serve in the BTA if there were pending cases still against them?
Some of these cases have not been filed in court. So in reality, there are no pending cases against them as yet. Some are filed against individuals. Nomdegear ang nagamit. So there is no certainty na sila yon. So these are some of the challenges and the issues that we need to resolve also.
How long do you think the process would take before this entire amnesty proclamation is completed in order for the MILF combatants to be able to resume their transition to civilian life?
We're hoping it would be quick. For one, Congress needs to express its concurrence on the proclamation. Second, the Amnesty Commission would have to be constituted. And then the MILF combatants would have to file their application for amnesty. So it would take some time to do that. But we're hoping this one would be quick.
Did it, isn't this late, the amnesty proclamation? Because I remember this was supposed to come sooner, right?
Yes, it's part of the CBM. And in peace agreements, the confidence-building measure normally comes earlier so that you build the confidence of the rebel organization to continue to engage with government. But this one came really a bit late. In fact, the first draft that we submitted to government was late 2014 when we were negotiating in Kuala Lumpur. Just immediately after we signed the annex on normalization, we already presented a draft proclamation to the to our counterparts in the government negotiating panel.
Why do you think it took time before President Duterte issued an amnesty proclamation?
We're not really sure. In fact, the first draft proclamation was submitted to the former president, President Aquino. And then when the new president was elected, a new panel was reconstituted, we also submitted a draft proclamation for this.
So why do you think it was delayed?
We're not sure really. One is that there was difficulty, I think, in determining the exact number of those who will benefit. There was also a debate in government whether it will cover all crimes in pursuance of the political belief of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front.
But and on the part of the MILF and also the BTA, how do you make sure that only those who committed crimes before related to their political beliefs or advocacies will be covered by the amnesty proclamation, and that those who are who might have been engaged in terroristic acts won't be benefiting from this?
We're also careful about that because, you know, of the split earlier in the ranks of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, and there was there were those who earlier advocated that we don't need the negotiations and therefore separated from the mainstream Moro Islamic Liberation Front. Some of them have actually engaged in acts that are not within the rules of engagement issued by the leadership of the Bangsa Moro Islamic Armed Forces. So we also don't want them to be covered by that. But at the same time, there are also members of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front who've been charged with terrorism. And so we'll have to settle that also with government.
Okay. And do you think this would actually expedite the normalization process, in particular the decommissioning process? Because some are saying that the process has been quite slow. And you cannot exactly blame just the MILF, but also the national government. And also because we're in the middle of a pandemic. But still, there are questions being raised regarding how successful this entire decommissioning process as part of the normalization process would be.
That's true, Christian. There has been concern expressed by the Moro Islamic Liberation Front that some aspects of the agreement has been moving very, very slowly. Part of that is the issue of amnesty pardon. And we're happy that this time, amnesty has been proclaimed by the president.
Okay, but for example, what's the calendar now? I understand the first batch of combatants numbered 12,000, right? But we're still talking here of 28,000 MILF members.
Yes, the next batch would be around 14,000. That's 35% of the combatants of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. We have the list already from the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. We're just waiting for some other processes to proceed before the list would actually be submitted to the independent decommissioning body.
If the BTA is not extended and the elections proceed next year for the BARM, do you think this could compromise the pace of the decommissioning process?
From a review of the process that has been undertaken earlier for decommissioning the combatants, it would no longer be feasible to complete the decommissioning process in the remaining 1 year of the transition period. That's already impossible to do. So we should seriously reconsider the issue of extending the period of transition in the Bangsamoro, because a lot of the aspects of the peace agreement has not been implemented as yet.
Is the parliament still working on an electoral code?
Yes. In fact, tomorrow, the cabinet committee that's in charge of drafting the electoral code would already be finalizing the draft. Once it is finalized at the cabinet committee, it will be submitted to the cabinet, and then the cabinet will transmit that to the parliament for enactment. This is the parliamentary system.
Yeah, but do you actually
quite different.
But do you actually intend to finish the electoral code, given the fact that you are pushing to hold off the elections next year?
Yes, we are committed to passing the electoral code before mid-year of 2021 this year, regardless of whether the period of transition extended or not. The Bangsamoro Parliament and the leadership of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front is committed to passing the electoral code.
So that should address concerns that the Bangsamoro Parliament might not be working in earnest to pass an electoral code, because in the first place, you guys want to extend the BTA in the first place. But even if that happens, no, let's say walang electoral code, tuloy yung election, of course, I think there's a provision. I mean, the COMELEC, the national, the one in Manila, central government, the national government, the Commission on Elections has that option, right, to still facilitate the elections even without the electoral code in the Bangsamoro. Is that correct?
In reality, it cannot proceed. The election would not be held without the electoral code passed by the parliament, because there are no rules governing the election of the members of parliament in all existing legislations of the country, or even in the legislation of the previous ARMM. It would also be difficult to proceed with an elections where the rules for parliamentary districts, party representation, qualification for candidates are not existing. So it's really impossible. But as earlier said, the Bangsamoro Parliament is determined to pass that, whether we are extended or there would be elections in 2022.
So are you still also working as if there would be elections next year?
Yes. For the parliament, the timeline is still 2022 to enact the priority legislation. In fact, by next week, the civil service code would already be passed by the parliament. Yesterday was the last deliberation in the plenary for the civil service code. Okay. By next week, they will already vote for the code.
And finally, are you also working to help educate the people in the Bangsamoro regarding this parliamentary elections that are scheduled next year? Because this is quite different. And we know that as we speak, a lot of people are still quite confused.
Yes, it's a complex election, actually. If we add the layer of the parliamentary elections, and there would be three sets of members of parliament that will be elected in the Bangsamoro. One would be parliamentary district representation. Second would be the party representation. Third would be sectoral and reserve seats. So which is quite complex. So if we add that to the layer of the national elections, the regular elections in the local government units, and you have a complex parliamentary system of elections, gets a bit complex.
Yeah, because you have a system of proportional representation that represents a portion of the parliament, and of course the reserved seats. But I hope people would get more informed or educated about this system. Thank you very much, Attorney Asin Arimbo, for joining us this morning, sir.
Pleasure. Good morning, and thank you very much.
Up next, Manila's former ambassador to the United States, Jose Cuisha Jr., joins us to talk about President Duterte's demand for the United States to pay to keep its visiting forces agreement with the Philippines. Stay tuned to Matters of Fact. Welcome back to Matters of Fact. Let's take another look at today's headlines. The World Health Organization cautions the Philippines against easing COVID-19 restrictions after Metro Manila mayors voted to shift to modified general community quarantine next month. The Philippines detects two new coronavirus mutations in Region 7. Some Philippine senators say there's no need for the proposed 500 million peso indemnification fund for recipients of COVID-19 vaccines. And Auring is seen to intensify into a severe tropical storm over the next 48 hours. Cybersecurity experts are warning the public about social media app Laika. The app lets its users pay restaurants and other merchants through gift cards in electronic mode or gems. Gems are earned for every engagement on the platform. Laika has attracted at least 100,000 users in 6 months, with celebrities and vloggers promoting the app. But the group, Computer Professionals Union, says users may just end up as unwitting subjects for large-scale market research. It says since engagement is the primary way to earn gems, this prompts users to share more information on the platform. Through the posts, the app can have access to users' personal data without them knowing how their information will be handled. Laika's policy or privacy policy also says it may disclose users' personal data to potential buyers in the event of a merger or acquisition. The Department of Information and Communications Technology also reminds the public to be careful with sharing information on all social media platforms, saying data is the oil of the industry. Checking on weather conditions now, Tropical Storm Auring seen to intensify into a severe tropical storm over the next 48 hours. State Weather Bureau Pag-asa says the storm is expected to make landfall over the eastern coast of Caraga region on Sunday. Auring was last seen 595 kilometers east of southeast of Hinatuan, Surigao del Sur. It has remained almost stationary over the Philippine Sea east of Mindanao. Light to moderate with at times heavy rain showers can be expected over the Caraga region, Davao Oriental, Davao de Oro, and Davao del Norte today until tomorrow morning. Now, last week, President Duterte said the United States would have to pay up if wanted to keep its visiting force agreement with the Philippines. Both of Vice President Lenny Robredo and Senator Panfilo Lacson said this was extortion. But for Malacanang, Duterte's statement was justified, saying the Philippines was not getting enough military assistance from its ally. For his take on this, we are joined by Manila's former ambassador to the United States, Mr. Jose Cuisha Jr. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Sian.
Okay. We've heard what the president said, and it was not quite surprising because this was already the tenor coming from the president even before, early in his administration, that the Philippines was not getting enough or what it should get from the United States in terms of military assistance. Is this true?
Well, I hope the president does not forget that this VFA is a two-way street, okay? It does not benefit only the U.S., it benefits the Philippines as well. The U.S. is providing a security shield for the Philippines. Without the VFA, this may embolden China to continue with its aggressive expansion in the South China Sea. And they may, in fact, build a military base in Scarborough Shoal that will enable them to have complete control of the South China Sea, which is, of course, going to be detrimental to the Philippines and to the other countries that have claims in the South China Sea.
Okay, but of course, we know that President Duterte is not exactly known for his diplomacy. He's quite brash, right? But do you think the strategy in dealing with the United States, basically demanding that the United States provide more support to the Philippines, do you think this could work?
No, I don't think he can intimidate President Joe Biden, unlike the way he dealt with President Trump. I think it's going to be unfortunate. And in fact, that was the word that was used by Ambassador Albert Del Rosario in his statement about this move of the president to get the U.S. to pay for their continued stay and continued implementation of the VFA.
But in reality, do you think the Philippines was really getting the short end of the stick when it comes to getting military assistance in real dollars coming from the United States, given the strategic importance of the Philippines in this part of the world for the United States? Because you have to talk about that context, really. Baka naman we're not getting enough, really.
Well, I think we should not look only at the military assistance that we're getting. We're getting a lot of economic assistance. Recall that they got $434 million from the MCC, the Millennium Challenge Compact. We were supposed to have gotten a second compact, but it was the Philippine government that decided to withdraw because of the concerns that were raised about the human rights situation in the Philippines. Philippines decided to withdraw it from the second compact. So we have other assistance that we're getting from the U.S., not just military assistance. We have a lot of assistance in terms of education, in terms of health, in terms of counterterrorism. They have been providing a lot of training, a lot of for our military forces. So we should look at the totality of what we're getting from the U.S., not just the military assistance.
Okay. Is it also fair for Malacañang to compare the amount of assistance, military assistance, that the Philippines has been getting from Washington compared to the kind of assistance Washington has been giving to the likes of Pakistan or even Afghanistan?
No, it's not. It's not fair because precisely Pakistan is a different situation. They have a much larger threat in terms of terrorism. We know what the Taliban have done over the years. So it's not fair to make the comparison.
Really, is that is quite unfair to make that comparison specific to Pakistan?
Different situation in the case of Pakistan. I think we have to look, in fact, at what we have been getting from the U.S., not just for the last 4 years, but over the last 20 years, 30 years, you know, we have been getting. Now, remember, after the bases were closed for about 10 years, we hardly got any assistance from the U.S., and it was very difficult even to make an appointment in the State Department. Ambassador Del Rosario can tell you that, because they were very upset precisely that we practically drove them out of the bases here.
But as a treaty ally of the United States, do you agree that the Philippines should be getting more?
Let me point out, in the case of Japan and South Korea, they're both allies of the U.S. They have bases, the U.S. has bases in both. And yet Japan and South Korea actually shoulder part of the expenses of the U.S. military forces. So it's the two countries that are paying, not all of it, but they're paying a fairly large amount to keep the base, the U.S. troops in the bases in Japan and South Korea.
But the difference
is... We're not even paying. They're actually providing us assistance. But the more important thing is they're providing us a security shield. Without that security shield, then we're, as the president himself has said, we're practically hopeless, helpless. And that's why they look to the U.S. To provide the defense that we need.
But of course, South Korea and Japan are much bigger economies, much richer than the Philippines. So don't you think that's quite understandable that they could afford to shoulder those expenses? Unlike the Philippines.
Well, you know, that can of course be argued, but I think it's going to be part of the negotiations when they talk about the VFA again to try to get the bigger amount, but to demand that they pay about $16 billion, I think is quite unreasonable.
And how do you think the United States would react to this kind of statement coming from the president?
Well, obviously they will try diplomatic means to try to resolve the issue, but if they cannot, then I think we will be at the losing end if they decide to walk away. Because without the VFA, they cannot implement the Mutual Defense Treaty and the EDCA. It hinders their ability to do that. So what's the use of the MDT and the EDCA to them? No?
But they think Washington can also afford to lose the VFA with the Philippines at this time?
I'm sure they don't want to lose the VFA. I'm sure they want to maintain the strategic alliance with the Philippines. But if we become unreasonable, I think President Biden's type is going to walk away. I hope they don't underestimate that.
Okay, but of course, Washington is also aware that that President Duterte is nearing the tail end of his administration. So while this might be seen as a strategy on the part of the president, he doesn't exactly enjoy the benefit or advantage of time, unlike the advantage that he had before, early in his administration. That's why I was asking how the United States might or likely react, because it's also possible that Washington can also just try to ride this out and wait for the next administration while keeping the existing security arrangements.
Yes, that may be a strategy on the part of the U.S., but I also don't hope that they don't get pissed off and then they just say, well, let the Philippines fend for itself.
Okay. Former Ambassador Jose Aquisha Jr., thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Christian.
Okay. Pfizer now in discussions with regulators to test a booster shot version of its COVID-19 vaccine, specifically targeted for the South African variant. A laboratory study released Wednesday suggested the highly contagious strain may reduce protective antibodies elicited by the Pfizer vaccine by two-thirds. The company proposes to do a phase one clinical trial of the modified booster shot. Pfizer, however, stresses its existing vaccine is still highly likely to provide protection against the variant, and the test is primarily meant to learn how to adapt to emerging strains. Mexico's president asks consumers to use less electricity in the evenings to help overcome a shortage in natural gas from Texas. Mexico generates majority of its power from natural gas, mostly imported from the United States. Its economy has reeled as imports dropped by about 75% over the last week, causing billions of dollars in losses. The governor of Texas said on Wednesday no natural gas should be supplied out of the state before February 21st, as it struggles to provide power during a rare cold snap. Texas is on the sixth day of freezing temperatures, which has killed at least 21 people and knocked out power to more than 4 million in the state. U.S. Senator Ted Cruz, meanwhile, is headed back to Texas amid widespread criticism over his holiday jaunt to a Mexican resort city, where while his home state grapples with a deadly deep freeze. Here's the full story.
As millions of Texans struggled through a deadly deep freeze, U.S. Senator Ted Cruz flew to the Mexican resort city of Cancun with his family. The 50-year-old Republican lawmaker confirmed the trip on Thursday, but cut it short after his travels were reported. Reuters snapped this picture of Cruz leaving Mexico. In a statement, Cruz said, quote, "With school canceled for the week, our girls asked to take a trip with friends. Wanting to be a good dad, I flew down with them last night and am flying back this afternoon. My staff and I are in constant communication with state and local leaders to get to the bottom of what happened in Texas." Cruz, viewed as a potential presidential candidate in 2024, faced calls to resign after photos on social media emerged showing him in an airport line, in a passenger lounge, aboard an airliner, and departing an airport in Mexico. The scandal came as millions of Texans remained paralyzed by power and water outages after a winter storm and freezing temperatures hampered efforts to restore full power. So far, nearly two dozen deaths have been attributed to the cold snap. Some in Houston found shelter at the Gallery Furniture Store, which had opened its doors as a warming center. Meanwhile, in Austin, a Target saw empty shelves and long lines as shoppers stocked up on food. With 2.7 million Texas households on Thursday still without heat, leaders warned of a domino effect on infrastructure as the lack of power cut off water supplies, strained the ability of hospitals to treat COVID-19 patients, and isolated vulnerable communities with frozen roads still impassable.
After a journey of nearly 7 months, covering 472 million kilometers, NASA's Perseverance rover has landed safely on Mars. Mission managers at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory burst into cheers as radio signals confirmed the six-wheeled vehicle survived its perilous descent and arrived within its target zone inside a long-vanished lake bed. The landing, which involved a complex series of maneuvers, was the riskiest part of the $2.7 billion endeavor. Perseverance is the most advanced astrobiology laboratory ever sent to another planet. It's on a mission to search for traces of ancient microbial life. Two subsequent Mars missions are planned to retrieve samples collected by the rover and return them to NASA in the next decade. A 21-year-old psychologist student's short story on mental health has been recognized in the 2020 Hammond House International Literary Prize in the United Kingdom. Christian Andre Laplap is a student at the University of the Philippines in Cebu, and his story titled The Oddity That Is Them has been picked to be published in the annual Hammond House anthologies. Laplap's short story revolves around two people who unexpectedly bump into each other and find that they still carry emotional baggage and trauma. Laplap said he wanted to emphasize the importance of taking care of one's mental health and share meaningful conversations amid the pandemic. And that will do it for the show. I'm Christian Esguera. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of ANC shows online by subscribing to the ANC YouTube channel. Connect with us on Twitter at ANC Alerts or email us at ancfeedback@abs-cbn.com. Catch us again same time tomorrow here on Matters of Fact.
It's a long road to peace in Mindanao, one that is beset